Good afternoon, everyone. We're going to get started here in just a second. So if you could come in from the outside, find a seat if you're walking in now. Hopefully those who are attending virtually today are able to hear me, and we're in good shape both in the room and for those who are participating online. Thank you all for being here today. My name is Brad Crowell. I'm a commissioner on the Nuclear Regulatory Commission. I'm the newest commissioner. This is my first RIC and my first panel at a RIC, so bear with me a little bit. I'll hopefully get both the logistics and the substance correct, but I'll be learning a little bit as I go. A little bit of housekeeping before we dive into the substantive nature of our program. If you don't know the Wi-Fi code and you need to get online, it's RIC 2023. You'll probably need that down here to access the app for the conference and submit questions, which you can do through the app by scanning the QR code that's in your binder or behind us on the screen here. If you're logged in online, you can do the same through the online portal. Other than that, I encourage everyone to ask questions for the Q&A. We're going to attempt all of us to do more interactive Q&A than speaking to you, because I think there's lots of questions in this under this topic that we're discussing today. So please do that. But again, if you're in the room, please do it through the app, and it'll get sent up to me. So with that in mind, this is our panel on transformation and modernization of the NRC environmental review process, meeting the challenge. And it is a challenge, but it is also one full of opportunities. Just in general terms, to kind of put the environmental review process in context at the NRC, probably most folks in here know, and I've learned over my time, 6 months with the NRC, is you have kind of the column on the safety review side of the equation, then you have the environmental review side of the equation. Oftentimes, that environmental review is synonymous with NEPA, but it is not exclusive to NEPA. It's much bigger than that. It doesn't necessarily mean it's a formal process always under a statute or a consultation process. Lots of what can and should be done in the environmental review process can and should be done informally, both early on and throughout the permitting process as appropriate. And we want to get into all of those things today and discuss the current process, where improvements can be made, lessons learned from either your experiences as a stakeholder, a permittee, a licensee, a local community, state government, tribal government, you know, what has worked well in the past, what hasn't, what are other agencies doing that we could maybe think about incorporating into the NRC process, and hopefully as we move into a period at the NRC where we are doing lots of environmental reviews, be it on the reactor side, the material side, or anywhere where environmental review is required in the NRC jurisdiction, that we're implementing best practices and doing it thoroughly, but also quickly, so that timelines don't drag out unnecessarily, but that we're meeting the full mission and scope of what environmental review process is intended to entail. We're very lucky to hear today to have a great panel to weigh in on these topics. Three of them are with us in person, and one virtually. I'm going to introduce them each one by one as they go through their presentation, and then I'll start off the Q&A, and I'll be monitoring the laptop for any questions that come in from the crowd. So without further ado, first I'd like to introduce Manisha Patel. She's with, she challenges the NRC for one of the best acronyms of the agency she's come from. But she's with FIPSI, the Federal Permitting Infrastructure Steering Council. Did I get that right?
Close
enough.
We'll let you have it.
Fair enough. Ms. Patel has been in this game a long time. She's been at FIPSI for a while, certainly since it's kind of come back into the fore. during this administration and since the major infrastructure bills have been passed. But she has spent time at CEQ focused on NEPA. She spent time at EPA regional office and in the private sector. So she's seen this topic from all angles. And the goal of her organization is to make major infrastructure projects go smoothly and comprehensively, easier said than done. But she's up to the task, as is her staff. And with that, Manisha, I'd be happy to have you give your presentation. And thank you for being here.
Thanks. Thank you, Commissioner, and thank you to all of the amazing folks at the Nuclear Regulatory Commission for hosting this annually, for welcoming us and providing a forum for these very, very, I think, salient, timely, and critical conversations. As the Commissioner said, my name is Manisha Patel, and I'm the Deputy Executive Director for the Federal Permitting Improvement Steering Council. That I gets everyone every time. Infrastructure is a buzzword. And in fact, as I look out, first of all, let me tell you, my heart is just so warmed at the number of people sitting in this ginormous ballroom, after lunch no less, all eager to listen to us go on a little bit about permitting. Wow, times have changed. I promised the rest of the panel that I would quickly go through a set of slides here, simply, and if you'll keep me honest and let me know on my timing. But I think that visually, there are a couple of things that will help orient you for those of you who are not yet intimately familiar with the Permitting Council, and that is, in fact, we could go with the FIPSI acronym, and for a long time the agency did, but I think Permitting Council, as a short form name, really captures what we're all about, because right here you see the seals of several agencies, in fact, 13 by statute. The council is an agency that is made up of the deputy secretaries from the 13 federal agencies who have a role in environmental review and authorization, along with then the chair of the Council on Environmental Quality, the director of the Office of Management and Budget, both executive Office of the President offices, and then a presidentially appointed executive director, my boss, Christine Harada. I put this up here, the slide, just to sort of underscore, we're a unicorn when it comes to federal agencies, because our job is not actually to permit anything or to do the environmental reviews and authorizations. Rather, our statutory mission is to help all those other agencies that I had up on the screen. It's to help the federal family do what they are already tasked to do by statute or regulation better. And by better, what I mean is not just faster, but more effectively, more efficiently, to really produce better environmental and community outcomes. And I think the commissioner nailed it on the head when he said, that is so much easier said than done. So FAST 41 is in fact a statute that was enacted in 2015. It was amended in November 2021 with the bipartisan infrastructure law, which made the agency permanent. And added a few additional authorities and capacities for the executive director. At the end of the day, and I'm going to put this in plain English, because trust me, I'll get up here and wonk out with the best of them when it comes to permitting. I love this stuff. But in plain English, what the statute does is provide predictability, not just to project applicants, but to other agencies beyond the lead agency who might be involved in a process, to the public who wants to know what's coming next, what's the next phase, when can I comment, right? So it provides predictability, transparency, and accountability. It provides a way for issue resolution, and that is key. I know that NEPA often, and as the commissioner said, it's not just about NEPA, it's Section 106, the Endangered Species Act, bald eagle and migratory birds, there's a whole panoply of federal environmental statutes that one must consider. And actually putting all those Jenga pieces together is what our agency helps do. It's all about the collaboration and the coordination. And how this all works is actually a publicly available dashboard. It's a website, permitting.gov. I'm gonna say that again, permitting.gov. Essentially, it takes every, and I realize it's a little hard to read, probably in the back, I'm not gonna call on anyone, but trust me when I tell you, what the slide contains here are the names of the statutes down the left-hand column, and then the timelines for where we are, and you can see that there's a bar that says, this is where we are in the process. And that way, everybody knows what's coming. And this gets posted after all the agencies come together, and within 60 days of a project being identified and posted onto this dashboard as a covered project under FAST 41, the agencies have 60 days to come up collectively with this. Now, is this going to change? Sure. Is there movement? Sure. But it is a little bit embarrassing for me to be up here to say, before FAST 41, we didn't have that as a federal family, right? It took a statute to make us do what I feel like maybe we ought to have been doing all along, but that's fine. We have a statute now that does drive this process. What we have found from where we sit is that because of that public transparency and because of the forced collaboration, and I hate to use the adjective force, but sometimes it does require a little nudging to get the agencies to come together. And it's not that they don't want to work together. A lot of times it's they just don't, they don't see the connections, or they don't realize, I don't need to wait until all of the information is totally there and perfect to crack open the application and start looking at it. I can start having discussions with the NRC right now on what they're seeing so that we can be prepared, and I can maybe even help shape what additional information may be required or asked of the applicant, right? It's, again, about reducing duplication and extraneous effort in the federal permitting process. So what we have seen is that because of the statute, there's definitely increased visibility and predictability for the public. There's more accountability and coordination. We see an alignment across the federal family, and this is my last slide, so don't get nervous. But I also would be remiss if I didn't take this moment up at the podium to tell you what FAST 41 isn't, right? It is not a get-out-of-jail card, or the analog to that in the permitting world, which is, I want my permit tomorrow card, right? It does speed up the process, but the way it speeds up the process, and this kind of gets to the heart of why there's delay in the process in the first place sometimes. NEPA gets kind of picked on, but honestly, sometimes delays happen because application landed on someone's desk, they're not sure what to do with it, they have six other applications that they do know what to do with, and so they start working on those other six. And then they come back to this one and they're like, ugh, don't want to do it. Having a process that puts everything out there transparently, there's a forcing mechanism. And so what we don't do is cut corners on the quality of the environmental review or the permitting process. It's not a short circuit to meeting all of the statutory and regulatory requirements that are already there. You know, under the combined process, the Part 52 process for NRC, you still have to follow that process. But think about this. If you're a covered project, what that means is you've got your safety track going over here, you've got your environmental review track here. Chances are you've got investors who are trying to watch you figure out, is this gonna happen, isn't this gonna happen? The dashboard provides a little bit of certainty and predictability. And so it's valuable in that sense. It does not cut corners on public participation, and certainly not any corners around consultation with sovereign tribes. FAST 41 itself doesn't prescribe any new process or any deadline. all it really does is make the process we have work better. And that's really the point. I know we're going to get into some discussion, so I'm not going to belabor this, but I will tell you again, permitting.gov, and honestly, if the FAST 41 process is something you're not familiar with, I do commend you to our website. There are a lot of projects on the federal dashboard. There's a tab that says FAST 41. There are more projects coming, but I think it's a very valuable tool, and it's going to get into some of the other bigger topics we're going to talk about, I think, hopefully today. You know, how do we permit for the future, right? We're so used to using the processes and doing environmental reviews and authorizations embedded in a culture that, quite frankly, sprung from statutes that were enacted 50, 75, 100 years ago, and for a different time and a different era. And so I think thinking about how we course correct ourselves and use the environmental review and authorization process to really deliver great projects for our energy grid, for our communities, and for the environment, for me, that's the holy grail, and it's what gets me up every day and makes me come into work. So I love it. Thank you.
Thank you, Manisha. I think there's going to be lots of questions for you about how your agency works when we get into the Q&A. And just for context here, really quick, you know, Manisha, you used the word covered, you know, if you're a covered project. So that's an important thing that we'll dive into a little bit more. But there are certain agencies that are called out as members of the steering committee.
Council.
And you know, in general, those projects are ripe or appropriate for inclusion on the dashboard. But really, any major infrastructure project that has an environmental review process should be utilizing the permitting dashboard. And I really wish that the C in FIPSI was for coordination, because that's really the value that you play. I think external stakeholders and local government will often, and tribal governments, think that, you know, take for granted that the federal family is coordinated amongst itself to do these things, and that's not the case. But FIPSI helps provide that service. So,
I didn't dig into the mechanics of how you become a covered project, but maybe we can get to that question.
Yes, I think that'd be great. Thank you. Okay. Our next panelist is joining us virtually today. I'd like to introduce Larae Bill. She is with the Shoshone Bannock tribe, and she's the interim tribal and Department of Energy director, and I believe also the current or previous cultural resources program manager as well, and a cultural resource specialist. Larae has experience with the Section 106 process within the National Historic Preservation Act, the Section 110 of Historic Preservation, which is American Graves and Protection Reparation Act, all of the NEPA, all of the traditional statutes that one goes through as a cultural resource specialist. She has worked closely with other federal agencies, as well as you know, some of you in the crowd and DOE laboratories and the like. We're very lucky to have her joining today virtually. And Larae, thank you for being here. And please go ahead and tell us more about your role and introduce yourself further. Thank you. All right, Larae, I'm going to let you figure that, if you can still hear me, I'll let you figure that out offline, and we'll come back to you. And we'll move from Larae to Ray Schiele with the Tennessee Valley Authority. And Ray is familiar to many of you as well. He's the licensing manager for TVA's new nuclear program. He's part of the TVA leadership in that role, and has been doing permitting and environmental reviews for most of his 45-year career, which includes service in the United States Navy, additional time as a nuclear power plant control room supervisor, shift manager, and most recently for 20 years as the senior project licensing manager at TVA. Comes to us with a unique perspective on how a local entity, a quasi-federal entity, works with various stakeholders in doing large infrastructure projects and small infrastructure projects, quite frankly, in a geographically diverse part of our country. So with that, Ray, please feel free to tell us more.
Commissioner, thank you for inviting me to participate today. It's a very important topic that we're all interested in, especially with the interest in deploying all sorts of advanced reactors. Good afternoon, everybody. As Commissioner said, I'm Ray Schiele, Senior Manager of Licensing for the New Nuclear Program, and I'd like to give you a little information about the Clinch River project and the New Nuclear Program, where we are today and our journey. So this is a little quick history of the Clinch River site and the project. As you can see, it was the original home for the breeder reactor project. Didn't get finished. What you see in the picture there is just the big hole and the base mat. That's as far as they got before they said stop and they did a reclamation. 2010, 2014, we started looking at technologies. Decided to do an early site permit. In May of 2016, early site permit application was submitted to the NRC. And in December of 2019, TVA was issued an early site permit for a small modular reactor, first in the country. In February of 2022, the TVA board decided to have a new nuclear program to evaluate opportunities to deploy advanced reactors in the valley. And in the summer of 2022, a programmatic EIS was approved and put on the Federal Register for the Clinch River site. So this slide here is just a picture for those of you who don't know where Clinch River is. On the picture to the left, you can see Knoxville, Oak Ridge, the Oak Ridge Reservation, and the little tiny pink area. It's expanded on the right, and that is the Clinch River site. It's bounded by the Clinch River arm of the Watts Bar Reservoir. Why do you say Watts Bar Reservoir? Because upstream of that is Melton Hill Dam, downstream is the Watts Bar Dam. So basically, it's a pool that is managed by TVA for level. So it's not a free-flowing river. That's where the site is. So here's some fun facts about the early site permit. In the red is some key milestones for pre-app engagement. There was an extensive amount of pre-app engagement prior to submittal. The more important details, though, are in the black, the key milestones for the NRC. The application was docketed in January of 2017, and the final environmental impact statement was issued April of 2019 with, as I said before, the early site permit issued in December of 2019. So it took, from an environmental perspective, about 28 months from docketing to issuance of the final environmental impact statement. We had an extensive amount of activity with audits, and they were very efficient. Safety side, environmental side, QA, we used the audit process to share information, get resolution on information issues, and eventually submitted just a few REIs that had to be docketed. The pictures there, just fun facts. The picture on the right, we're trudging into one of the bat caves. On property near the Clinch River site. And on the far left, that we had all the core bores out for inspection. It was an interesting audit. The bottom line is the information sharing, both in the face-to-face portions at Knoxville Towers and then going out into the field and comparing that information with field studies proved to be invaluable. It was a very good process. So you heard me mention a programmatic EIS. Why did we do a programmatic EIS? The Clinch River site is designated to be an advanced nuclear reactor technology park. We want to be able to deploy multiple reactor designs as demonstration projects. To do that and to be forward-looking, a programmatic EIS evaluated the impacts of multiple designs, multiple megawatt levels, impacts to the site. And the purpose is, as you can see on the picture, there's two. One in the purple is area one, one in the yellow is area two. Area in the purple there is where probably most the demonstrations will be the larger reactors. And the yellow area will probably be like micros, smaller. Programmatic EIS was issued in July of 22. So it was a big accomplishment. It's the next step forward for the technology park. So what's the TVA new nuclear program? Well, as you can see on this slide, the board said we're going to go evaluate all technologies that are available and make some forward-looking decisions to support our carbon reduction goals. And right now we are looking at the feasibility of the GE-Hitachi EWRX 300 as a possibility for licensing at the Clinch River site. So here's the roll-up of our journey, the vision for TVA. We've done site investigation. We've done a technology evaluation. And right now we're doing extensive planning. Part of that planning is, can we put a construction permit application together? Can we put together an environmental report application that's successful? If so, and then with board approval, we'll submit those two applications to support deployment at Clinch River. Successful deployment at Clinch River will enable the next two columns of the fleet focus is multiple deployments in the valley, maybe multiple SMRs at some sites, with the ultimate goal of the carbon reduction by 2050. So that's the vision of Clinch River and the new nuclear program for TVA. Thank you.
Thank you, Ray. Do we have Larae back? Have we sorted that technical issue yet? Larae, give it another shot. Try and talk to us.
Can you hear me?
There you are. All right. The floor is yours. Please go ahead.
Oh, okay. Good afternoon. I guess it's afternoon over there. It's late morning here. I'm Larae Beal. I'm an enrolled member of the Shoshone Bannock Tribes in Idaho, Southeast Idaho. I work for the Shoshone Bannock Tribes Culture Resources Office, but right now, for the past, almost 2 months now, I'm the interim Tribal DOE Director, Tribal Department of Energy Director. So with our program, we, DOE Idaho, they interact with the Shoshone Bannock Tribes by doing their consultation or any activities that DOE Idaho proposes on the Idaho National Laboratory site. And so they work through the Tribal DOE Department and also my other department, the Culture Resources. And so one project that came up in 2016 was the small modular reactor project. It is now called the Carbon-Free Power Project. And so we've been working on that since 2016. We were told this was kind of new for them to, for NRC to interact with tribes. We had our hiccups with consultation and doing the culture resources reviews. But now we are going forward, and DOE Idaho has been very informative with us. We've also met with the contractor, UAMPS, a few times, and it's going forward, and we're just waiting to hear what is next on the CFPP project. Also, we ensure that all federal agencies, including DOE, contacts us really early in the process when they decide to have a project. Although the Idaho National Laboratory is 50 miles north of us, it is still part of the Shoshone and Bannock tribes' ancestral territory. We stress that federal agencies consult with the tribes because the Shoshone and the Bannock people, we have a large ancestral area, and it basically it runs from southern Canada into Alberta and all the way down into Mexico. That's how far we've traveled prior to the European contact. There's even stories that some of our people went all the way down into South America. So, but mainly we focus on Idaho as our ancestral territory because it's so close to where we are now. And so, yes, the tribes, we really stress consulting with us early, especially with the cultural resources part. We have a lot of history out there, meaning there's a lot of archaeology out in our area. So we need to protect that and preserve it as much as we can. With projects, we like to have, if our sites can be avoided, that's what we'd rather have. Like, say a transmission line's going through an area, and they come upon an archaeological site, we ask them to move it, say 100 feet north. That's a part of mitigation to protect our site. And so, yeah, we, in our business council, our leadership, the Fort Hall Business Council, we report to them and make sure, and DOE Idaho is pretty good about coming to our business council to give us briefings, give the council briefings on projects and updates. And we work really well with DOE Idaho. And this was kind of new to us, working with NRC. And so we're learning too, the COLA and the application process. So, and we look forward to working with NRC more. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Larae. And we'll look forward to hearing more from you during the question and answer period, both from your experience with your tribe and tribal government, and also any general lessons or pointers you can provide for interacting with different tribal governments, each of whom, as we know, are unique. Last but not least, I would like to introduce my NRC colleague, Ken Erwin. He's the branch chief in the Environmental New Reactors branch at the NRC currently. He's been at the NRC for almost 25 years as a technical reviewer of spent nuclear fuel transportation and storage tasks. He has since moved on to positions of progressively more responsibility, including financial analysis, new reactors licensing technical assistant, external hazards analysis team leader for oceanography and meteorology. And for the last 7 years, Ken has been the chief of the Environmental Review New Reactors branch, and has a deep appreciation and understanding of NEPA and its related laws and processes from the NRC perspective. And we look forward to hearing more about your role, Ken. Thank you.
Thank you, Commissioner, for that wonderful introduction, and thank you, everyone, for coming to our NEPA session. I'm one of three branch chiefs in the Environmental Center of Expertise. We are a group of about 40 NEPA professional project managers and technical reviewers. And we also have several contractors that support us in undertaking our mission. But I'd like to give a special thank you to PNNL, They give us just invaluable support in accomplishing all of our casework and helping ensure that the agency meets its casework goals. And our group is responsible for agency compliance with all of the NEPA and related laws. So, you know, I think people have talked about it already a little bit. NHPA, ESA, there's just a raft of rules and regulations that we implement. So I always like to give a presentation like this, and I like to put the agency's mission up. When I took this job, I started reading this mission to say, the NRC licenses and regulates the nation's civilian use of radioactive materials to protect the environment. And I'll tell you, almost every single licensing action that this agency does goes through our Environmental Center of Expertise. It's really an incredible amount of work. And the dedication of the staff and the contractors and the NEPA professionals, I've never seen anything like it at the agency in my career. So this next slide, I like to use to sort of illustrate the agency's dual mandate. We'll focus on this session on the left one. So, you know, the environmental review, we really look at impacts on the environment from the facility. And, you know, we have our authorizing legislation. All these rules and regulations. Really, we use 10 CFR Part 51 to complete our mission. And the outcome is an impact-focused document, and it's a disclosure document. And generally, we do EISs, but we also do CADEXs and EAs for all the various projects under review by our Center of Expertise. So here, I like to sometimes think about processes and flowcharts. So this is a really good way to look at those two different types of reviews that the agency does. You can see you get a lot of pre-application activities. We're really trying to increase that. That really helps increase the efficiency and effectiveness of our reviews to have really strong pre-application engagement, and we're seeing that for a lot of major applications that are coming in new reactors and in license renewal and materials. So I won't spend too much time on this slide or go through every box, but the environmental reviews on the bottom. And you can see there really is a lot of public engagement in the environmental review. That's one of the things that struck me when I transferred over from being a technical reviewer in the safety side of the house over to the environmental side of the group. So I also like this slide quite a lot. So this just shows a lot of the technical review areas that we cover during our review. And you know, NEPA being a disclosure-based document, you know, the technical expert or the analyst who's doing the review, they'll describe the current environment that's at the location of the facility, the baseline conditions. They'll look at the consequences of the proposed action, and then they'll also look at each reasonable alternative, and they'll look at the consequence of that, and they'll write all that up and disclose all of that to the decision makers. And we also take a look at cumulative impacts. So any activity on the site that's been known from the past, present, or reasonably foreseeable future actions. And this is my last slide. Manisha covered this pretty well already, but we do an immense amount of coordination with other federal, state, local, and tribal governments. And that's another thing that really struck me when I transitioned from the safety side of the house. We really spend a lot of energy working with these other organizations. And that's my last slide, so thank you very much.
Thank you, Ken. I'm sure there'll be lots of questions for you on more specifics about how the NRC process works or could work differently. I think I'm gonna start off going to Manisha, because some of the questions that have come in are reflective of ones I had already prepared to ask based on her presentation. I think there's a general appetite to hear more about what falls within FIPC's purview. So like what kind of agencies, what kind of projects, and then whether FIPC's role is one of describe the difference between coordinator and kind of gentle implementer pusher.
Sure.
Yeah.
Is this thing on? Not the the most graceful thing that I've done all day today, but that'll work. Let me see. That was a compound question, Commissioner. I'm just going to see if I can unpack that a little bit. Let's start with how do you become a covered project, or even actually one step before that. What are the sectors that are covered under the FAST 41 statute? And, you know, I realize I should have explained that acronym before I just dove into the content of my slides. The acronym comes from Fixing America's Surface Transportation Act, and it's Title 41 of essentially the Highway Bill, the Surface Transportation Act from 2015. There was, back in 2015, I think, a recognition that the federal family really did need a singular forum for all of the myriad agencies and statutes that come to bear on the environmental review and authorization of infrastructure projects. So when the statute was enacted back in 2015, there were 11 sectors identified. Energy, so renewable energy, wind and solar, but also nuclear. Conventional, meaning oil and gas, are among the sectors that were identified. Also identified manufacturing, just basically your panoply of, if you're going to build an infrastructure project, the sectors that Congress identified would have captured that. Congress, in its infinite wisdom, decided that wasn't quite enough, so they added carbon capture, utilization, and storage in 2020. The Permitting Council, by vote, which it has the authority to do, added mining, critical minerals mining, and then most recently, with the Inflation Reduction Act and with the CHIPS Act, a whole panoply of additional sectors were added around semiconductor manufacturing. One that I think we're all still kind of trying to figure out, one of the sectors that was added was artificial intelligence. And I'm not sure exactly what that would mean from the standpoint of infrastructure or a project. I don't know. You know, my brain goes immediately to sci-fi movies when I think of an AI project. So leave that where it is for now. But suffice to say, there are currently 16 different sectors, and we need not dive into the specifics because I think generally for everyone in this room, energy, the generation and transmission of energy is covered. Now, how do you become a covered project? The statute lays out three criteria. One, it must be something that's subject to NEPA. Now, that does not mean that you have initiated NEPA. You don't have to wait until you file your until an NOI is put out by the agency. But if you know, and in general, mostly under NEPA, we know the kinds of projects that are going to be subject to NEPA. If there's a federal hook, you're going to be subject to NEPA. So subject to NEPA, and then in the original statutory language, there was a requirement that the project be have a value of $200 million or more. There have been subsequent amendments to additions to the statute that have added language that removes that monetary threshold for tribal projects. The final sort of key criteria is that it has to involve more than one agency, right? It kind of makes sense. The way the process works is if you are a project applicant or a project sponsor or proponent and you would like your project to be subject to the FAST 41 process, then you file what's called a FAST Act Initiation Notice. The acronym we use is FIN. I sometimes wish that I could play Scrabble with all of the acronyms that come rolling off my tongue every day. I think I would be unbeatable. But FIN is what we call our the application that you file with the Permitting Council to become a covered project. And in that, you just have to show that your project actually is a viable project. little bit around the costs and the value of the project, the permits you anticipate and authorizations you anticipate having to acquire, generally geographically where it's situated, basically a description of the project. Once we receive that, the federal family has 14 days, 14 calendar days, I'll say that again, 14 calendar days to decide whether it's a covered project that meets the terms of the statute. If so, we post it. There is no, if you meet the statutory criteria, your project is a covered project. Once it's posted, like I mentioned before, within 60 days, the federal family has to get together and come up with a nominal permitting schedule that covers soup to nuts all the different permits that you may need to get. Of course, the statute allows for modification of that permitting schedule as things happen in the real world. But I think those are the big values. I will say just one last thing that, you know, I think part of the challenge that we face here in the US when it comes to environmental reviews and authorization, and I love, Ken, I love that you identify the mission of the agency in the way that you do. I think that's exactly right. But one of the challenges we face is that over the years, Congress has enacted statutes, environmental statutes, statutes to protect our natural resources, our air, our water. They have singular purposes. They have a mission. And the agencies who are charged with implementing those, I mean, I've been with the federal government coming up on three decades now, and I really can't even think of any exceptions that I sit up here. Everybody is committed. People are mission-driven. They believe in what they do, and they try to do the best they can. And where we run into issues as a federal family trying to permit a particular project is because everyone has their own missions that they are committed to. And so sometimes that means that you've got one statute that kind of butts up against another, and it's in that sort of coordination and conflict resolution that the permitting council can really play a role.
Thank you, Manisha. So. I think it was helpful for me, so I think it's helpful for others as well.
That was a lot of words, so well, sorry.
And I'm wondering if Ray and Ken can put a little bit of color on this in terms of how either TVA or NRC has engaged the permitting council in terms of what it offers or how you maybe intend to leverage it going forward. And maybe, Ray, I'll turn to you first.
Yeah, thank you. I don't believe TVA thus far has engaged the council. It doesn't mean we won't in the future. TVA has so far a good record of permitting, turning around environmental assessments and environmental impact statements. But when new opportunities hit where there's volume and new regulations come through, there may be the need to garner some efficiency from engaging the council. So yep. It's not off the table.
Yeah, and I'll just add from the NRC's perspective. I mean, we have been working with FIPSI from the very beginning. We have attended every meeting. We under both administrations, we sent a detailee down to help stand up the previous administration's implementation of FIPSI. And I will just say that the work that they do with best practices and sharing best practices and allowing us to share best practices and interact with other members of the federal family, that's really one of the things I've seen great benefit from is really, you know, seeing what other federal agencies have done that's worked, seeing what's not worked, listening to the presentation, seeing the projects on the dashboard. I personally am keen to see an NRC project go up on the dashboard. Right now, we don't have any, but I
don't think there are any right now. We've had some in the past.
Yeah, in the past, there were some.
There were some, and they were, again, the thing, in the real world, when you're building a project, so many different things can happen that may or may not result in a project getting to construction, let alone operation. And so the process is the process, right? It's not determinative of the outcome per se, in the sense of the environmental reviews. And so I think the handful, or three that I'm remembering, two or three, of the projects. We did have NRC projects on the dashboard, but they...
They finished.
They finished.
Yeah, we got them done.
Yeah.
So they were COLs, yep.
Yep.
Thank you both. Larae, could you tell us a little bit from your experience if a if either a private project a proponent, you know, someone who's going to engage, you know, wanted to do a large infrastructure project, or a federal agency who was involved in the permitting process for a large infrastructure project, if they haven't worked with your tribe before, what is, you know, what's the 101 on how they begin that engagement? Where who do they call first, and then what does the process start to look like in general terms?
Okay, so if the proponent is like a private company, they will have to go through the federal agency they're getting the permit from to do the project. So the federal agency would have to begin consultation with the tribes, because our tribal government only works with federal agencies, the consultation portion. The proponent, the private company, they can have meetings with our council, but that would not be considered true government-to-government consultation, because they're a private agency. The true government-to-government consultation would be between the tribe, our leadership, which would be our council, and the federal agency.
Thank you. And Manisha, and then Ken, I'm going to have you jump in on this one, too, in a second. Yeah, go ahead, please.
If you want to go.
Well, Ken, I was going to ask you, you know, earlier in your slide presentation, you noted the pre-application process and engagement. You know, it could, and I think we could all benefit from understanding who that involves and what it means. I mean, generally, I would assume that pre-application is with the applicant more than it is with other stakeholders, but it doesn't have to be exclusive to just the applicant. That being said, with certain stakeholders, like a tribal government, you can probably engage at that point, but it doesn't constitute consultation necessarily. Is that fair?
Absolutely, yeah. I mean, our pre-application really is an information gathering process, and the goal is sort of twofold. Yeah, one, we want to meet with the applicant. We want to understand the technology. We want to understand where they're at with their environmental report. But we also want to reach out to, you know, federal, state, and local agencies, you know, groups that are impacted. And in fact, we went out, that's kind of how I met Larae. We went out to Idaho back in October with the goal of sort of understanding one of the future applications that's coming in here, the Carbon Free Power Project. And we had a whole special trip to go meet with the Fort Hall Business Council, talk about who we were, why we were out at the site, and start building that relationship with the tribe and interacting and sort of reaching out and letting them know if they had questions that they could come and talk to us. And in fact, we've done it for a lot of other different applications. You know, there's a really interesting project in Alaska where the Air Force is talking about procuring a microreactor at an Air Force base there. We went out there at their request and sort of gave a similar presentation to what I gave today, and just talked about who we were. You know, we got pulled into the state of Alaska. They wanted us to give that presentation and talk about what we were doing and what our role is and our mission. And even right now, there's a Native American organization called the Tanana Chiefs Conference. They're having a convention right now. We have a team of people out there right now at a table at that convention talking about, hey, we're the NRC, here's who we are, here's our website, and really just trying to reach out and build that tribal engagement.
Thanks. Yeah. Thanks, Ken. Manisha, go
ahead. Yeah, I just wanted to, I actually chimed in earlier to echo something Larae had said to underscore the value, even as a project proponent, project applicant, there is a lot of value in reaching out and establishing and developing the relationship with the tribes early on so that you understand what the issues are, what the concerns are, where there may be sensitivities. There is no worse feeling as a project manager than having designed a $100 million preliminary design only to then realize there may be protected native and cultural resources there, and you've got to go rejigger that. Like, if you talk early, you can identify some of that stuff early. With that said, I want to underscore, and Ken used the word relationship, and I think that's exactly what it is, but for tribes, they are sovereign nations. They're not just stakeholders like any other community group, and so that there is a higher level of public trust that is comported to them under our public trust doctrine. And so there's a very special component to that discussion, which is the consultation that Larae mentioned, which is what Ken is talking about the federal agencies doing. But all of this is to underscore something that we've seen time and time again at the Permitting Council, regardless of what sector the project is in. The most successful projects and the projects that actually get built on time, delivered, you know, per spec, the successful projects are the ones where you do have all of the parties coming together and talking. And that doesn't mean it's always kumbaya, and I think that's the real takeaway, right? You are potentially going to have conflicts or disagreements or differences of opinion, but working that all out is precisely what the interagency process is about. And oftentimes I'll hear people say something, oh, we have a problem. We found, you know, we found pottery. Well, that's not a problem. Like, the process, Section 106 is designed precisely to do that. So that is the process working. And people talk about NEPA taking an extra 2 months or an extra 3 months. By gum, folks, I'm going to tell you right now, take those 2 to 3 months, figure it out, because you don't want to spend 2 to 3 to 4 to 5, 6, 7, 8 years in litigation, only to be told by a court to go back and do the very same thing you could have done in 3 months. So these are lessons we are learning by having a public dashboard where we're actually seeing and documenting projects as they go through the process, and doing exactly what Ken is talking about, is sharing information across the federal family of what works, what doesn't work, and when it didn't work, why didn't it work? So, thanks.
Yep, and an applicant should be able to gain that same insight by looking at the, you know, past projects that have come to completion,
exactly,
or ones that are further along that have similarities. Every project's a little bit different, but still. Ray, I'm going to ask you maybe an unfair question, so if it is unfair, you can toss it back. But okay. Even odds it is. So TVA has more than just nuclear assets in their energy portfolio. You know, can you enlighten us at all to the differences in the permitting process, the environmental permitting process, with respect to working, say, with the EPA versus the NRC?
Yes. So as a federal agency, TVA has to follow NEPA, and whether it's a categorical exclusion process or an environmental assessment or environmental impact statements, whether it's for fossil, nuclear, coal, the process is the same in evaluating the impacts. And as a consulting agency, TVA has consulted with the EPA and asked them for comments on their draft environmental impact statements. However, because the NRC is a separate from our permitting process, we don't consult with the NRC because they're reviewing a separate product, right? But we have consulted with EPA on our.
And then I assume you've got the state level permits as well that get thrown
Absolutely.
In there too. So yeah, no shortage of stuff to get through. And Manisha, does the permitting dashboard capture the state level permits that are necessary?
Excellent question. So there is a process by which a state can opt in and be held accountable to the same timelines and requirements of the dashboard. That's an opt-in process for states because, again, a federalist system that we have under the Constitution, you can't just automatically subject a state to federal, certain federal requirements. So states opt in if they want to. What we have found is that one of the requirements of the statutory process under FAST 41 is that agencies develop what I referred to earlier as a coordinated project plan, of which the permitting timetable is a part. That is an opportunity where, as the federal family starts talking to one another and identifying who's a cooperating agency, who has, you know, how are all, as I said before, how all the Jenga pieces are going to fit together, it's an excellent opportunity to reach out to states, even if they're not formally a part of the process. On the dashboard, we've got a couple of projects. They are sediment diversion projects down in the Gulf of Mexico, where the state of Louisiana has opted in, signed an MOU, and we actually just issued the record of decision for the first of those projects this past December. But again, I think that it is the coordination and the collaboration forcing mechanism of the statute that allow the engagement with state agencies and to identify that and be cognizant and aware of where that fits in. So it's kind of up to the state. We can't force them.
Okay, thank you. So I think as most of us know, there's been a recent effort to look at where to site new nuclear generation projects. And one of those concepts is to do it on, you know, former brownfield sites, and specifically coal, places where a coal or natural gas plant was that has shut down, or a coal plant that may be slated to shut down. And there's potentially lots of opportunity there, but there's potentially also lots of complications there as well. And it's still early in the process. The Department of Energy has done a report that it identifies sites and site characteristics and things like that. And you know, Ken, I'm going to start with you and see if you can just offer any insights onto how the NRC is thinking about the permitting challenges and opportunities of potentially licensing a reactor on a former site of a former coal plant.
Yeah, and thank you for the question. So it has come up recently. I do think there are both challenges and opportunities with licensing a reactor on a coal plant or a closed coal plant. I think, you know, you've got a lot of infrastructure in place already. I think there's probably, you know, MET data. You've got Endangered Species Act data. You really can gain a lot of efficiencies. I think from a NEPA perspective, there's probably transmission lines already built. You're not plowing under wetlands. I mean, there's a really, from a NEPA technical perspective, there's a lot of things I think you can incorporate by reference. You know, do a new and significant review. I think that really could inform the NEPA review. I think some of the challenges, I guess, and you know, maybe I'm not really my area of expertise, but there's, you know, there could be some waste on the site. I think there's some questions of liability. How would you do your radiation measurements, for example, if there's, you know, coal ash laying around and things like that? So I don't know. I don't know, Ray, if you have any insight into.
Yeah, I mean, it's a really good question that a lot of people are looking at right now. Clinch River is the only site that's had a siting study that's been selected. But as aging power plants need to be replaced with whatever kind of plant, you have to go evaluate the sites that are available. And brownfield sites or aging coal plants that are going to be retired, they do offer some advantages. You have transmission lines. You have a switch yard. You have, for TVA managed water supplies throughout the valley. It probably has an area that the workforce is supportive of replacing that with something new. So there's lots of advantages of taking a hard look at brownfield and coal sites that are going to be retired.
Thanks, Ray. In an effort to confuse everyone even more with all the federal government is doing to streamline and make the permitting process easier, Manisha is going to turn to you to maybe speak about a recent event, or at least the recent report released by the Steering Council along with CEQ and OMB, that was providing direction to federal agencies with implementation guidance for the Biden-Harris permitting action plan. You probably want to start first with what the action plan is and then how the guidance and et cetera, et cetera.
Sure. Yeah. Last summer, the Biden-Harris administration issued the permitting action plan, which in a stroke of genius is precisely what it's named. I think when you look back over time, you see that every administration has had its imprimatur on infrastructure permitting. The previous administration had an executive order. They created a system called One Federal Decision. That was revoked. But when the Trump administration came in, they had revoked the Obama-era EO around infrastructure permitting. So the Biden administration has issued a plan, not an EO, a plan. And what is different, I think, about this one, and what has me really excited and I think was spot on, is that this particular permitting action plan approaches it from the standpoint of what do we in this country need as infrastructure? How is infrastructure going to support jobs? How is it going to support the communities in which the infrastructure is built? All of this is sort of folded in into the policy of the plan, and the approach of the plan is really to take a look from a cross-sector, like they've identified six sectors where they've created cross-agency teams, the critical sectors. And so it's really a plan. Energy is one of them. So it's really a plan on how we're going to take and apply the lessons learned over the last several years, the best practices, as Ken was saying, things we know as a federal family work, and also has a fair measure of things that we aspire to. That plan, that policy document, necessarily needed some additional guidance for the agency, specific guidance on, you know, what kinds of projects and how will the agencies work together and what are the policy aims and the policy goals of the administration. And so that is the guidance that was provided to agencies just last week. And I would say the big marquee item in that guidance is direction on how to identify transparency projects. So I spent a little bit of time earlier discussing the sectors and the process for FAST 41 and the criteria. The statute also allows the executive director to post on the dashboard projects that don't meet all the statutory criteria, but in the interest of transparency, could benefit from that public exposure, the predictability and accountability that comes from just being posted on a dashboard. And so what the guidance is internal direction to federal agencies on how to identify those projects, and the executive director's office is gonna work with the agencies to identify those projects and post them onto the dashboard. So this gets at some of those projects that may not meet the $200 million threshold, but nonetheless, we all know it when we see it that, like, that's a big deal kind of project. Those kinds of projects will get posted, and this is direction to the agencies on how to do that.
Thank you. That's helpful. I'll admit I haven't read the action plan recently, and I haven't read the implementing guidance either, but does it include items like environmental justice and tribal consultation?
Oh, absolutely, yeah. Okay. Yeah. These are how, I mean, and again, I think certainly the Biden-Harris administration has leaned into those concepts very heavily and rightly so. But I think as a federal family, we've also recognized that, again, as I was saying in response to Larae's comments, if you're a project applicant, at this point, it should just be part of your game plan to know that you should be looking at making sure that you're doing the appropriate cultural consultations, making sure that the community in which you're siting is part and parcel of the early discussions. It's a smart practice because it saves you a lot of headache and having to redo stuff at the back end. And at the end of the day, we do what we do. Again, I wish I could just flash the mission statement again, Ken, right? We do what we do to improve all of our lives. And so it doesn't make sense to build out infrastructure for the future by repeating some of the mistakes of the past and doing that, building that infrastructure out on the backs of a few. And those are lessons we've learned over time. And so we shouldn't repeat those.
Okay, and that makes sense. And I'm gonna put Larae on the spot here and truth test that a little bit and see if she can offer any perspectives on whether the engagement and consultation between tribal governments, and I guess you can probably only speak for your specific government, and the federal agencies have gotten better or worse, or which specific areas where it maybe has been improved, but other areas that need improvement. Like, you know, where do you see things right now in terms of how well the federal family is doing in engaging tribes and fulfilling the consultation obligations?
Well, I think it's gotten really good since I started working for the tribes, which has been like 20 years, especially with DOE. They have gotten really good at consulting, giving us information, and plus it helps when our leadership, our business council, is adamant about these federal agencies coming to us to consult and give us updates and inform us about projects. Other federal agencies, since we work with most all of them, I would say Forest Service needs a little bit more work. DOE has been doing really good. They're very, the way they give their updates and information to our leadership, they make it so that our leadership understands what the projects are and what each project entails. And so, yeah, I would give kudos to DOE.
As a former DOE alum myself, I'll give a little bit of kudos to DOE as well, but give them a scapegoat as well, which is it's easier for an agency that is more of a giving out resources agency than one that is a solely focused on regulation agency. And there's a different kind of interaction that goes with those two missions and functions. And there's pros and cons of both, but that kind of begs the other question, Larae, which is, you know, how much are resource constraints a real impediment to the your tribe being able to engage effectively with one or more federal partners on a particular project? Are you able to keep up and have the resources you need to do that engagement, or is it a challenge in most or all instances?
Oh, Commissioner, I'm so glad you asked that question. I think that is, no pun intended, a million-dollar question.
Okay.
Go ahead.
Fire away. Larae.
We are able to keep up with a lot of the interactions with the federal agencies. Sometimes it becomes overwhelming, but I think we do a pretty good job.
Yeah, and I piggyback on that?
Please.
Because I think this is another aspect of FAST 41. I was joking earlier about, back in the day, permitting was not cool. Okay, and I was a nerd sitting in some dark office in the back halls of EPA. Nobody wanted to hear what I had to say about rulemaking or the Administrative Procedure Act or any of that stuff. Made people's eyes roll back. It is the hot topic these days. And what I'll say is one nice thing about that is that Congress has appropriated a lot of money with the bipartisan infrastructure law and then the Inflation Reduction Act. I think you see a real emphasis on, as a federal family, not just the executive branch, but the legislative branch as well, putting our money where our mouths are. And to that end, Congress gave the executive director $350 million under the Inflation Reduction Act to help improve the timeliness and efficiency of the federal permitting program. And so we are looking at different, and it's really nice because the executive director pretty much has like direct transfer authority. We're working through the mechanics of how we do that with the agencies, but the statutory authority is there to move this money. And one of the very primary areas that the executive director has already identified, she's already earmarked at least $5 million of that money as starter money, seed money, if you will, to build out tribal capacity so that tribes can engage and so that the time that it takes to do a consultation is not hindered because the tribe is unable to find the resources that it needs to be able to meaningfully engage and participate. And then, of course, that money comes with sort of support, the tools, the training. And so we're actually walking our talk. We had a consultation with the tribes on where does it make sense to put this money? How should we set up the program? But that is one of the big things that I think the Permitting Council can serve to do. In addition to the coordinating function, the executive director can essentially throw money at resource problems. And I think that the resource issues, our workforce, is probably right now, I think, on the minds of most federal managers front and center.
I was actually just going to add that, you know, there's a lot of money out there, but it's a little bit harder to find the right skill sets.
Exactly.
And you know, you don't want to compete with other federal agencies, and I know FIPSI's got some initiatives to kind of help with that too, but that's probably one of our biggest challenges is, you know, is hiring up to our budgeted number. I mean, Congress has given us the budget we've asked for, but hiring up to it and then executing and then getting ready for all this case. We're going to see a wave of casework coming from all of the infrastructure, you know, Inflation Reduction Act and the infrastructure laws is really going to result in a lot of work. And so I think there's a lot of opportunity, you know, out there in permitting across the federal government, at the NRC, at FIPSI, all over. So,
can you, without even talking telepathically, I think, but I'm going to stick with you on that theme and try to bring this home a little bit as relevant to as many folks in the audience and listening online as possible. You know, as we, the title of this conference is Navigating the Nuclear Future. So, you know, as we navigate that nuclear future, how is the NRC working to make the environmental review process work more effectively, more quickly, without undermining the goals and requirements of the various statutes included in environmental review? Like, how are you going to be modernizing environmental review, or you and your team at the NRC, to make sure that this renaissance is not held back because of antiquated permitting rules?
So absolutely, and I appreciate the fact that you said that, you know, we do want to make sure that the agency's NEPA goals and compliance are not challengeable. And so that's always the forefront of our NEPA professionals. Their analyses have to be extremely high quality. Probably the biggest innovation that I've seen a lot of innovation in my career at the NRC. The biggest one was the creation of the Center of Expertise. So we used to have three separate groups doing NEPA in three separate offices in three separate business lines, and they were dedicated professionals. They were doing great work, but there were quarterly meetings, but there were really never any kind of cross-pollination. So we created the ECOE, and it just unleashed a wave of innovation. And so, I mean, you get all the benefits of centralization. You get centralized, you know, you have centralized SharePoint, centralized guidance, centralized handbooks, a lot of mentoring capability, a lot of increases there. But one of the first things we did was we took a look at our NEPA documentation itself, and especially from the nuclear renaissance, the large light water reactors, some of these documents were massive. I mean, 1,400 pages, very difficult, I mean, redundant, very difficult to understand. So we started over from scratch, and we created a template that anybody in the COE can use for a CADEX or an EA or EIS. And I mean, it was a long process, but one of the outcomes of that, we just published the Kairos DEIS a few months ago, and it was about 170 pages. from 1400.
Awesome.
So that's a big, big deal.
So awesome.
Big accomplishment. And the other thing that we really, really wanted to look at was generic evaluations, right? And I was actually really happy to hear Commissioner Barron talk about the license renewal guys this morning in his remarks, and he even mentioned the A&R guys in his remarks. So we came in and said some of these facilities have been around for 40, 60, 80 years. Surely there's got to be, you know, increased use of generic environmental impact statements that we can do. And so, you know, the license renewal guys is on the street. The draft is right on the street right now. If I put a plug in, there's a public meetings on Thursday in this hotel at 2 o'clock and 6 o'clock. So if anybody's interested in that, you know, please come to that meeting. And then, you know, we came up with another huge innovation that I really couldn't believe it when we did it, was the A&R guys. So we had just finished, I think, 15 environmental impact statements for large light water reactors. I mean, it was a huge investment by the agency, a huge effort. The environmental staff really had done an exhaustive review, and we said, what can we do to sort of capture all this knowledge from all of these reviews? And we created the A&R guys. So we came up with the concept of a technology inclusive, performance-based document with like something like 140 different variables, going back to that slide where I had all the technical parameters, 140 of those, where, and then the staff divided them into categories 1 and 2, where if you met the plant parameter, and we invented this thing called the plant parameter envelope, the site parameter envelope. So if you met the parameter that came up, like for example, if you were going to use, I'll make this number up, but if say it's 30 acres and you're not going to disturb any wetlands, you, if the A&R guys is approved, you will get environmental review finality on that parameter. And so we really see if we get this huge wave of advanced reactors, and some of these things are pretty small and they're located at sites that are pretty remote. Now you still have to do ESA, you still have to do EJ, you still have to do tribal consultation. Those are all outside of the category ones, they're all in category 2. So those are some pretty major things that we've undertaken. I guess the latest thing we're doing, we're gonna revise our environmental standard review plan. This is the guidance that all of the Environmental Center of Expertise uses to provide guidance to the staff. It hasn't been revised since 2007. So we just launched that initiative. I think last week we got the funding moving forward on that. So those are some of the things that we do to really try and make these reviews go quicker. I mean, we have a lot of other little things. We have schedule goals, page goals, you know, we have quality goals, all of that as well. But I think those are the main big efficiency generators from my perspective.
And I appreciate that, Ken. And I, you know, when I ask Ken a question, I'm always cognizant of the fact that it's asking myself the same question, because, you know, we're in it together, and that's success is only going to be achieved when the commission and the staff are closely aligned in understanding what needs to get done, why, and just playing off the same page. And I've been pulling questions from the audience and integrating them into the question I've been asking today. So hopefully you've noticed that if you asked one of the questions that I've referenced. And someone did send in a question that was directly to me, and I think it's a good one to end on and also build on from what Ken said, which is, how has my perspective on environmental reviews changed going from being a, running a state level environmental regulatory agency to a federal one? For those of you who don't know me, my quick bio is spent most of my professional career in DC at the federal level, but before the NRC most recently, I was the head of the Department of Conservation and Natural Resources in Nevada, which is a diverse entity that has environmental permitting, historic preservation, tribal review, fire, water, whatever, you name it. And you know, one of the big differences that I learned is that environmental review is not just about the strict permitting process and going through the boxes of what this law or this regulation requires. It's about looking broadly at who all the stakeholders are, building relationships, and making sure that even the folks who aren't, you know, directly part of the permitting process, that they are still informed throughout the whole process as to what's going on and why. So that at the end of the day, you have a community that is supportive of the ultimate project being there, or at least has trust or faith in the permitting agencies that allowed it to move forward. And so, you know, I think that's something that NRC is hoping to do better going forward, is in addition to these improvements and reforms that Ken mentioned, it's also just doing that everyday public outreach and engagement to make sure we're talking to the community and anyone who wants to be kept informed or made aware of the project or be more involved. And if you want to be more involved, the NRC is a tough place for the average person to figure out how you get in the process, be it from a commenting standpoint or as an intervener or whatever. It's a challenge, and so it's to the NRC's benefit to be doing that outreach writ large, both within the guidelines of a permitting process as well as more broadly. And that's how we're going to build our relationships with tribal governments like the Shoshone and Bannock and many others, and local communities where TVA, you know, serves so many local communities, many in impoverished areas that need these jobs, these infrastructure projects, but they want to know how it's going to benefit them. So it's all part of the big picture of being a responsive federal agency and a responsive family of federal agencies who ultimately it's the taxpayers and the American citizens that we work for. So kind of the big picture goals there, and always much to be improved upon, and we at the NRC at the very least are gonna continue to improve upon it and look where we can leverage resources and relationships like we have represented on the panel today. And with that, thank you all for being here. Thank you to our panelists for participating, and look forward to working with all of you going forward. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.